So, it's 7 p.m. Let's start. Bonsoir, mesdames et messieurs. Bienvenue. The topic of my short talk is about a little mail series that occurred in 1993 between January and sort of July. The idea of this mailing list thingy was to copy the famous newspaper from the German CCC, Die Datenschleuder, and it was adapted for the French public. The twist is that what you know at the CCCF was actually piloted by the French Secret Services, which makes these emails a little bit more spicy, would I say. So, what you see on this slide is one of the very, very first popular sign clients that existed in France, called the Minitel, that was distributed in Saint-Malo as test pilot. And for the fun fact, the keyboard layout was ABCD. So, I gotta say, of course, everything is in French, or almost everything is in French. And yeah, now there's actually some things in English, but of course, it was oriented for a French public and therefore in French for some parts. So, what the hell are we actually talking about? The CCCF, Chaos Computer Club France, it was created by the Directorate of Territorial Surveillance and dissolved in 1990 something. We don't know. There's no trace of an official dissolution. And the Chaos Digest was the name of this email service that was trying to copy the Datenschleuder. So, as a fun fact, they had an ISBN number, which sounds quite strange for a mailing list, but yeah, first publication, of course, in 1993, and there's unclarity about when was the last email, because I've seen sometimes that there was a second volume of this email in 1994, that we are going to see on the next slide, that's the ISBN data. You can go in the Bibliothèque Nationale de France in Paris, ask for that exact number, and you'll get a floppy disk. I don't know why. I'm not sure if that sounded suspicious or they were hacker because they can. I don't know what to say. And there's another name that you can see right here, Mr. Conda, that you'll see in a video very soon. That more or less was the guy TM for this suspicious organization that you can see in a short video of 1 minute in the next slide. He is in France 3, and I'll just show it. It's in French, of course, but what it's doing should give you an idea already.
Je veux savoir, est-ce que je peux rentrer dans le ministère de la Défense irakien?
Bah, c'est
Je
pas
veux
compliqué.
savoir, je veux savoir combien de munitions ils ont en ce moment dans leur stock.
Voilà, page 629 de ce chemin. Irak, le réseau est IDAS, IDAS, géré par la société qui s'appelle BTC. Le code d'accès, 0 pour sortir, 4180 code d'accès. Ensuite, vous cherchez dans le paragraphe d'avant, je n'irai pas, le numéro de l'ordinateur central de la société BTC, à qui vous allez demander l'ensemble des ordinateurs
Bon.
gouvernementaux, médicaux ou...
Bon, j'arrive à Irak et je peux ensuite décliner.
Vous descendez dans l'arborescence, comme dans une architecture, en demandant
Mais
systématiquement...
personne ne s'en aperçoit.
Oui, je pense qu'il y a des mots de passe à l'intérieur, comme
Francis,
absolument pas,
Il n'y a
car
pas de mot de passe qui bloque à l'intérieur
comme le disait mon cher collègue, il est totalement possible hein, et
Oui,
directement.
Philippe Legorju, oui, c'est vrai, vous êtes devenu collègue de monsieur. C'est bon.
Il m'a sorti mon fichier personnel tout à l'heure.
D'accord, oui, non, mais il en fait d'autres. Oui, il y a pas
Philippe Legorju.
So, yeah, I mean, when you see this video, I mean, it got to be paid. It's unbelievable. He come here with a Minitel. Remember, it's a thin client that connects to a main server hosted by France Telecom. And says right here on TV, he can hack the Iraq Ministry of Defense and see how many munitions they have. And there's no password or whatever. He just takes his book, opens it, flips it. Oh yeah, here's the number. Then there's a chapter here. I won't say which chapter, of course, that's secret. And then, boom, et voilà. I mean, look at that, wonderful. I mean, come on, come on. So, what happened in these publications? For the first batch, I don't have access for the second one. If I can find a way, eventually with Bibliothèque de France, maybe it's the second talk. That's more than 2 megaotets or 2 floppy disks of data. What you see in white are publications where there's at least one copy of VHMag, the publication. So that's, of course, out of scope. As you can see, there was an interest at the beginning, and then it slowly faded, and you can notice at the date that it was very active at the beginning, and then slowly it fades down, and it gets publication from others, emails, groups, to be slightly active. So, what does the header look like? Well, this. It's interesting to see that they accepted publication in English, French, and German. They knew why. They knew why. After a few publications, you also had a list of FTP mirrors with the domain name and the IPv4 address. So, let's go in the very, very first publication. What was interesting? And they started a little debate about a book. This book, the Little Book of Computer Viruses, and the debate was if it was a good idea to translate it in French and if it was a good idea to publish it. And the discussion was very, very heated. We'll see later. And these mad lads actually translated it in French, not in this title. That was the planned title, but actually it's here. Naissance d'un virus. You can still buy it online, used, if you want. And for science, if you want, but the original is in PDF. You can download it in English. Just use your Google View and it's very, very easy, believe me. And as usual, ISBN of the book, which is very, very interesting because the Bibliothèque Nationale de France said they messed up with the ISBN, it's wrong. And as you can see here, the first arrow, Jean-Bernard Condat was the translator of the book. So I'm not going in the details of this heated conversation. It was extremely long. People were for the publication in the name of science. People were against it because in 1993, viruses were a huge topic, and you can see that very, very often. Today it's crypto, whatever. Times changed. And I'm just going to take one quote out. And this guy was extremely surprising by his accuracy. Where basically there was something with John McAfee, and he's very, very good at marketing and making money. And I mean, 25 years later, something never ever changed. It was very nice. So, the next email was written by Olivier Itenau and talks about French legislation about, of course, viruses, unauthorized penetration of systems, compromising of systems, and so on. And You can quickly see on Wikipedia, he's still active today, and he is a very famous lawyer, at least in France. And yeah, I'm not going into the detail because French laws are boring and slightly out of scope. So yeah, you can still see all this text after the talk. I'm giving a link where you can quickly see that if there's something that you find interesting, just dig in. The next email that I'm going to show you was extremely interesting for its time. Remember, we're in 1993, the Soviet bloc isn't here anymore, and they weren't so advanced with internet. So how did they connect the old CCCP block to the internet? And we'll see now. It was mostly between one link between one entire country and one university, mostly in Austria. I'm sorry for the wall of text. But I want to point something very special. There was a UN ban on Yugoslavia, in effect, and therefore could Austria single-handedly cut the internet connection of an entire country, which today isn't possible, of course. Some countries were also lucky enough to get a 9.6 kilobyte second connection to the CERN in extra. Next email, just silly little fact about Unix time. People liked it to trick left and right about the system configuration to make it harder for hackers. The perfect example is here, where Mr. Condat decided to put his Unix time at -1 to trick the other computers, which of course today will give at least some issues regarding certificates expiration and so on, so the trick couldn't really work anymore nowadays. The next email is again, sorry, a wall of text. And what happened this day? It was an alarm that the CCCF might not be trustworthy at all. I snipped a part that is irrelevant for this case, where they basically complained that it was difficult to get the entire mails. And that's a hacker from the USA who warned everyone that something's fishy here. Now I'm going in some hardware specifics issue back then. You might know that. The Clipper chip, it was a big talk once upon a time that governments couldn't access to encrypted data and that it should change. 25 years later, it's still sometimes a hot topic, which I find surprising. And that's a little talk about the crypto chip that was planned from the NSA. And on the next slide that I'm going to show, that's how they explained it to the White House, how they could use that backdoor for law enforcement services in the USA. Which was, yeah, something. The next talk is a very French invention. That was the bebop. And the idea was, it was GSM 0.1, which basically worked like wireless networks. You had one antenna in a big town that worked for 300 meters. You could notice that you were in the Earth area because there was a stripe green, white, and blue. And it worked somehow in France because the prices were slightly cheaper than the GSM. To give a little bit of idea, the phone costed 1,890 francs. And the communication costed 83 cents, which means today 0.13 euro per minute. It was discontinued in 1996 because, of course, the GSM took the market. Next one, I'm going to go very quickly about this one. It's the ASCII codes of Minitel, how you can program the Minitel to work at, for example, in which speeds, in boats, custom characters, how the cursor works, different colors. If the Minitel was capable of colors, it was almost always black and white. And that was a little cheat sheet of the entire possible combination. Then, next one. Yeah, as you can notice, we were quickly from January to now May. As I said, after the newbie effect of the mailing list, it quickly dropped down in activity. So the next one was a call for a convention. And au menu in this convention, you had camping, of course, workshops and conferences. I'm going to cite two because it was big topics, phone freaking and hacking and the law. What was the fines and jail time if you and to being caused by the cops? There was also some notable workshops. I'm going to cite some. Email networking, should we destroy X400 or shall we let it destroy itself? Or, of course, art of lockpicking, Unix security, and brand new thing, wireless LAN data radio, which was, back then, a very novel concept. So, next one is a liked email that was really the hit back then, ASCII art. There was hundreds of lines of code jokes, and that was the sole email of the digest that day. Why not? What was the next one? That's again a technical release where you had specifications of the idea to get an antivirus on a ship. The idea, I'm going to take PC Magazine that was released shortly in the same time. The ship 7855 from Western Digital checks the entry and the read-write action of the hard disk. And if it detects something suspicious, read a virus, it suddenly stops. And on the software in the operating system, you will get an alert asking the user if he should continue or abort. Viruses were really the big topic back then. So, next one. I'm almost at the end. This one is particularly interesting as well. That is the cousin, the project, it was called Fortress afterwards, which used RSA. And the idea was actually GPG 1.0. We are in 1993, and the first version of GPG, the mail and so on cryptography system that we know, was released in December 1997. So that's a precursor. It worked slightly the same with a huge difference. You had in Dublin a company called Baltimore Technologies that was the CA. It was centralized. From there, you had specific privileged users that could certify that the key that the user wants is valid. And that was more or less the precursor of GPG. It was funded by the European Union, if I'm correct. I need to check that again. Then the last email, the best one. That was 800 lines of an interview from Jean-François Condat, which with the clickbaity title, Should We Crucify Him? And that was the next in here. Can you find the explanation why is it called Chaos Computer Club France? Because as you can see in the email, it's often mentioned that this has no relation at all with the CCC in Germany. And the origin of this name is he was with four friends. They were working in medicine, mostly psychiatry or that thing, and they were looking for a name. That's the story, the official story. And in that name, they looked at the CCC in Hamburg, and they probably also looked at the Datenschleuder, and they thought that's an excellent idea, because it's a percutting name, it's already well known, and the semantic of it was assumed to say that computers are scary and so on, it can break things, it can fix things, and they decided to take that name even if they have absolutely no connection. That's the official story of it that you can read in this email, in French, sorry. It also talks about the non-problem of virus, which according to him are only affecting 0.2% of computers, and that therefore we shouldn't take so much attention to this. And the best one at the end, he was complaining with the lack of cooperation with the French secret services. I mean, when you see that and you know that he's coming from the French secret services, that's something very interesting. Also, that was the last email from this batch that I could find online. I really tried hard to see if eventually there's something else which I couldn't find. Eventually, I should ask the Bank de the Bibliothèque de France if they have something. You can find all these emails on this wonderful FTP server. I'm going to write that on pre-talks if I have the possibility. I'll see. And this FTP server, side note, is absolutely a goldmine of information on retro IT security and so on. Go have a look if you have some time to spare. And from my side, c'est fini. Merci beaucoup pour votre attention.